Well, I'm going to make another video today about this 440T4 transmission rebuild that was originally going to be in frame, but found out I had to change the torque converter, and therefore I had to pull it out. I've got a camera tripod that a friend of mine gave me a while back. I'm going to try to use. This camera doesn't really lock into it properly, so if I go to make adjustments, well, I just hope you've taken your anti-motion stick pills. Some of y'all may remember from a post a while back, I recommended not trying to change the torque converter seal when you've got the transmission out for other reasons. If you put a junkyard transmission in, what have you, if it's not leaking, don't mess with it. And the reason I say that, this is the one I took out. And you can see I used a seal puller. This tool here is supposed to get in there and pull it out, stick it in beside the shaft. And I was able to tear right through the steel before this came out. The proper way to get it out is through this slot. You knock it out from the back with a screwdriver or a punch. So if you can't get this out and you scratch up this bore, you're going to have a leak, external oil leak. If you gouge up the shaft, the torque converter bushing rides there, and then your torque converter bushing is going to self-destruct, contaminate the whole transmission. So unless you are very sure you know what you're doing, I recommend you don't try to just pry this out and change it if you have the transmission out of the car for other reasons, because the chance of damaging your transmission is actually very high. So only change this if it absolutely has to be done, and then if the transmission is disassembled, it can be driven out from the back. And that's how I had to get this out. I couldn't get it out with the seal puller. And the new one, the tripod, the new one is very thin, and it only has to be driven in by this edge. If this part in here gets bent at all, it's going to leak. It's going to ride crooked and leak. So this is not something you want to do unless you really have to do it and you have the proper driver. Okay, got that seal driven in there. This is my first time with the tripod, so I keep got to bear with me. I gotta make sure the camera's really looking at what I think it is. This 2¾-inch socket is the perfect size for a driver without bending that, so I got that tapped in. Another thing, this transmission is going on a half a million miles, literally. It's over 450,000 already on it. So there's some parts wearing out that you normally don't see worn out. This bushing is where the final drive goes, and the original one, it's not bad, but I could see it was getting there, and I had to order a bushing set anyway, so I went ahead and drove in that bushing. It wasn't hard to do, but I did have to make a modified socket. I took an 1⅛-inch socket and put a step on it there where that bushing would fit, and turned the outside of it down a little bit smaller so that I could first drive out the old bushing and then drive in the new one. And now, one of the drawbacks to the 440T4 versus the 4T60E and 65E, this doesn't have a removable final drive cover. So the final drive is really the first part that goes in. And if you just wanted to change the gear ratio, that means you have to completely gut the transmission first. And that's an awful lot of work just to change the gear ratio. Here's the final drive. Got a needle roller bearing, and then this is the part that goes into that new bushing. This is what drives the speedometer and the transmission governor. And this has got a hardened black hardened shaft, so this is one of the good ones. Being that this car's an 89, it was new enough to have that. Alright, with the final drive, the bushing felt good, so no problem there. It has a selective washer. It's stuck by oil. But, that washer, you can get those in many different thicknesses. That is to set the clearance. There's a measurement of the clearance after all the final drive parts are in there to ensure that there's not too much free play in it. I got the bearing a little dirty. But bearing on there, thrust washer is in place. There's another bearing goes down in here. Now, if you got the 3.3 final drive, these planetary gears are so moved inward and you can't get that bearing out, it's trapped. I don't know what the drive ratio of this one is, but it's not a performance car. So that's two something. Let's make a comparison. Okay, this is a 333. You see this difference in the size of the sun gear and that bearing is trapped. So this one you never have to worry about it falling out, but not going to make a hot rod out of mom's car, so it's going to get keep what it had. Okay. That part in there. This is the input shaft to the final drive. That's the parking lot gear. Another thrust bearing. That one needs to be have grease on it, because if it doesn't have grease on it, it'll fall out of position and get damaged when everything is pushed together. Get out the trans gel. A little bit of that on there. Now that'll stay put without falling out. Make sure this is on video. Like I said, this is the parking gear. This is a parking pawl. Why they named it Paul, I don't know. Should have been George. But you can see gears turn freely. If this is pushed down, no, the axle is locked. So there's a mechanism I'll show later that is actually riding in this top of this, pushes it down. Now, this whole assembly has to be put in as a unit. Let me make a camera adjustment. And the easiest way is to use the output shaft as a handle. Okay, found it. There's a retaining ring that goes here. And it comes in from the back after this is all finally assembled. The retaining ring goes right in there. But for now, I'm not going to put it on because I want to be able to take the shaft back out. This is a little bit tricky to do. And I hope I can do it on camera without looking like a total clumsy moron. Okay, now that that is in there, I'm going to lock this snap ring in place. Different colors indicate different thicknesses. Going back with all the same parts, so shouldn't have to change it. We'll probably measure it anyway, just to be on the safe side. This one usually can start it by hand and then lock it in with a screwdriver. I couldn't really video the snap ring going in because I was blocking the camera. It's pretty much done by feel, and I couldn't get a shot of that, but it's in there now. So that part is done. Turns freely. Park lock. That part's working. One step closer. Now I'm going to put the first and second band servo in. This activates the band that's used for first and second gear. There's a seal ring that goes on there. Put a new one. It's a cut seal ring, so you got to line up the ends. Put a little this trans gel assembly lube in there. Protect it. Now this one is kind of a pill to get in there because, as you can see, it's got quite a spring behind it. And this cover has to go on. And then a retaining ring goes on with the cover. So all that has to be pressed in, then the retaining ring popped into place. And there's a O-ring that goes on that too. everything out of the kit. Roll it on there. Make sure the O-ring, place where the O-ring slides past isn't dry. Slide that all the way around. So, it'll work. I don't know if I'll be able to video this or not because it takes a lot of force and I may have to lean right in front of the camera. But we'll see. This thing can be somewhat of a pain, but usually not too bad. The trick is to make sure the snap ring is fully seated and expanded like that, all the way out. Because if it's not, that thing can pop out of there. And believe me, a lot of oil comes out really fast. Put a little air pressure on that, check it. Working. Don't see any, hear any leaks. Around the cap.
That's good.
Now, this is the 1-2 band that goes down in there. Works off of that servo. You can see it's pretty dry. I need to put some transmission oil on that before I put it in there because it needs to be, it's friction lining, so it needs to be wet. If it's not wet, it will not grip the drum and then it will burn out first time it tries to apply. Alright, got a little oil on there. This 1-2 band, it had to be slid out around some other parts to do the in-frame job without taking the output shaft out. But now that I have the output shaft removed, it should be pretty easy just to slide it in place. It does have to be kind of flexed around a little bit, and there it goes. It's locked on the pins and on the servo. Now the next thing that goes in there is a thrust bearing, and this thrust bearing goes behind the drum. This is what that band is going to grip. It actually is a brake band. It stops this from rotating, and that works with the planetary gears to help it make first and second. Got that surface, has a bearing. This one is pre-lubricated inside the new bushing I've replaced, and there's that. When the servo pin extends, it simply stops that from turning. It's all its only job. And that has to be held still in first and second. Okay, now that that is in place, so the next thing that comes is this planetary carrier. Got the four planetary gears in it. These transmissions are pretty darn strong compared to some. I've seen some other makes where there was only two pinions in this. This one has 4 points of contact with every gear, so it's really hard to just break it with too much torque. And that splines into the final drive shaft. And this lube dam fits in there, and that's the reason the output shaft has to go in next, because that has to slide over the output shaft from the end. The shaft has to go through it. Alright, one thing about the output shaft, these flat spots here are really important. If you read the manual, it explains why, but if those aren't there, you need to grind them into the shaft. Has to do with lubricating oil flow. And along the same line, the output shaft bearing, they recommend taking out four of the needle rollers to allow for oil to travel along the length of the bearing more freely. Apparently they're having some trouble with this bearing burning up. That's what the update book says to do, and I've never had a failure of this after that's been done, but I sure have found the factory setup destroyed before. Bearing in place, got the little channels for oil to flow through. According to the service manual, that's an important thing. I'll put this in. Got the lube dam in there, the bearing with the four rollers missing. Or actually, there's 3 points. One side already has an opening in it. I want to explain something about the output shaft. This is the retaining ring that goes on there. And it has to be done through this opening. And if you drop it, it can be hard to get it back out. So I like to get that done before I get all the guts in the transmission. So if I can't get it out, I haven't wasted so much time tearing it back down to find it. And that's the main reason I didn't want to try to do it in the car and try and get this clip out, just so I could save the time of sliding that band around all the gears that wouldn't come out. But one way to get this clip in is to use a magnetic screwdriver and turn the transmission completely upside down where it can hang down straight, and then it'll go in. That's probably the technique I'm going to use here, but I know I can't get the camera to video that, so I'll cut back to it after that's in. Alright, before I get too much further, these two pipes have to go in before the rest of the gear train, or else they can't be installed. And it's really bad to get the whole transmission together, go to hook up the valve body, you don't have anywhere for these to go. So, right now there's plenty of room. Slip in there, locks in place. Now, that's that. Output shaft snap ring is in. Can then move on to getting some more of the internals in there. As you can see, there's not a whole lot of room. And if you had all the rest of the gears and clutches, it's not possible. Next comes the rest of the planetary system. There's a thrust bearing inside there. And this one can definitely fall out of position and cause all kinds of headaches, so it really needs to be retained in there with some grease, transgel grease. Just put it on there and make it sticky. Mash it down in there, and that's going to stay. If that falls out of position, then the little plastic lube dam, there's already one in there, but this piece, like that, will get busted. And if that gets busted, it will really shorten the life of your transmission. So you don't want that to happen. So go in next with this. Everything has to put together. Gears aligned. Now for the sun gear. That all turns smoothly. Okay, I took the sun gear back out because I want to make an important point. There's some oil ports drilled in this. That needs to line up with an oil port. This spacer, these tabs do not need to line up with the oil port. They need to leave the oil port free. One oil port, nothing blocked. Because when the sprague clutch goes in, it needs to have as much oil flow going through the splines back into the clutch as possible. And there's two oil holes here, three slots. At least one of them needs to be directly in line, like so. Now, these are one-way clutches. It's free wheels, it cannot turn that way. Free wheel, locked. This one is the opposite. Free wheel that way, locked that way. And the book explains exactly how this is supposed to go together, because if you get it wrong, your transmission will not work. So we're just going to put this whole assembly back in with the sun gear still in it. It's easier to feel if everything else is lining up right without the roller clutches in place. So I usually slide the sun gear in one time, get everything meshed all the way, then take it back out, put that on there. Makes life a little bit easier. Next thing is this. This is actually a shaft, but we always call it the cheese grater for obvious reasons. Also help keep these pipes up out of the way while the rest of the parts go in. Okay, now for the reverse servo. It works about like the 1 and 2, but it has a lip seal, and as always, the lip points toward the pressure. Pressure is pushing it down to activate the band, so the lip of the seal needs to face up. And same drill with the cap and the O-ring and the snap ring. Just takes a lot of force to get it in there. Lubricate the bore with trans gel and make sure that the seal doesn't get in a bind. This stuff's good because it won't contaminate the transmission. If you put too much in there, it'll mix with the transmission oil. It won't damage anything. So if you put regular grease, it's bad for the transmission. But that stuff, you don't have to worry about putting too much. You can put all you want, and it's not going to affect it any, damage it. All right, now for the input housing to go in. It has a thrust bearing that goes down in here. And once again, time for some trans gel. That way it doesn't fall out of position, because this doesn't go in easy. This is one of those things that you have to just work it in there, because all of the clutches, their splines have to line up with the roller clutch and sprag splines. All these little splines here have to line up with the splines in there. And there's no real easy way to do it other than just push it in and keep working it. Just set it down on the bench a little bit lower. Sometimes it's hard to tell if it's in there all the way or not, but at the end, when it's all the last parts go on, there's a measurement of a gap right here between the sprocket support and this case, and if it's not lined up, it's obvious. But I believe that is in. Now, time for the reverse band. Needs a little bit of oil put on it. Nice and messy now. If that is not locked in properly, you will not have reverse. So it's important that the servo pin is locked into the tab on the band. Now, the second gear clutch, for some reason, if the thing loses hydraulic pressure, it'll slip before any of the others will. And these clutch discs were this color to start with. And they say you can't tell by the color if they're good or not, and they're still porous, and they probably are okay. But clutch discs are cheap, and I went ahead and got a new set here, so I'm going to soak these in transmission oil and put them in the second gear clutch. Get it where I know it's good. No questions about it. Oops. The clutch has the paper lining plates, and then it has the steel plates. And those are that color because they're treated. There's some kind of surface treatment on them. That's the correct color for them. But the paper plates or line plates are not supposed to be black. Okay, got these all oiled up. Want to make sure there's no dry spots on either side on any of them. The oil is what does the work. That when hydraulic force is mashing all this together, surface tension of that oil film is what's actually driving the car. So if these are dry, they fail, because you saw it's just paper. It's a special paper, but it's just paper. We'll stack these up. And there's a little slot for oil to run out of, so those slots need to be staggered. Look down there. Okay, clutch plates are in. Now time for the retaining ring. You can look at it, and you can see one side has marks where it's in contact with this housing. The same side needs to go out. Some snap rings have a rounded side, and if they're put in upside down, they can come out. But I don't know if that one's rounded or not, but I don't want to take a chance, so treat it like it is. Now, this clutch can be kind of a pain to get in there, because this spline of the outer housing has to engage with the shaft that we call the cheese grater, and the inner splines have to mesh with the input housing. So this one may take a little while. Quite often it's easiest to stand the transmission up on end where gravity works for you, so I may not be able to video that, but I'll try. Okay, I set the clutch drum down in there. Keep turning the shaft back and forth. Drops in line by line. Try to engage to the it's in there all the way. Set this back down. This drum is in the band. That is in place in there. There is a roller bearing, thrust bearing, that's in place in there. I don't know if you can see it or not. It was in the back of the input housing. And now it's time for the driven sprocket support, this piece here. These new seal rings were installed, and it's been sitting with them compressed for a day or two, about a week actually. So that'll help this to slide in without binding. This is the hole that goes to the lube pipe coming up from the bottom. So you know that has to face down. But to make it easier, borrow these two long bolts that come from the charge pump. Just pick a couple of holes to use and make handles. And, that'll give you something to hold, work it in there. I'm going to reposition the camera. Alright, I oiled all that up. And try to slide this in. It's one of those parts where sometimes it goes in easy, sometimes it doesn't. Alright, partially in. Now what I see, it's staying out like that. That probably means there's a clutch. One of the clutch discs is not fully engaged. So I will stand it up on end again and try to get it to drop down a little more. Like so.
there it goes.
Now, here's the critical part. There is a specification for the amount of inset of this driven sprocket support. This piece, the part I just put in, it must be below the case. In other words, this part is in further than this part. There's a step there. There is a spec for how deep that step is supposed to be. And to measure that, you would press the final drive in to take some slack out of that and measure this step. But once again, this was a running transmission. I did not change any of the hard parts that would have affected that. So I know it's not different from the way it was before. It's below the case. So I'm going to call it good. Everything turns freely. So that's, for the most part, that's the gear train in. Okay, now it's time for another air check of the clutches. The sprocket needs to be in there to hold everything in center, or else it leaks. So bear that in mind. And once again, I've still got the fourth clutch marked, so no air pressure will go and blow out that piston. Which, man, that'd make me mad if that happened. So I'll start with the second gear. Working. Next one. Sounds good. Sounds like all the clutches are working. Means I didn't break any seals putting that together.